Let's get into the functional programming. Okay, so I'll share my screen. So before I start, let me say this is a webinar. So I'm going to show some code, but you don't have to take notes. This video will be available in YouTube shortly. You can go back to the YouTube video and pick the code. I can also share the files with you. That's not a problem. My one prerequisite for this webinar is I assume all of you have some kind of a coding experience. What is a loop? What is a variable? What is a function? What is branching? So some programming experience will help so that you can take your programming standards to the next level, that is functional programming. And another request is this is going to be more of a concepts. Though I have used Scala to write the code basis, write the code snippets, but it is language agnostic. You can write this functional way of coding in variety of programming languages. I have listed down the programming languages. I have used Scala, but don't worry if you don't know Scala. We will understand the code, but the focus here is going to be to learn the concepts and apply in your day-to-day programming. I do apply functional programming in my day-to-day coding work. So I feel this is very nice and this should be the norm, but it's less popular. So I thought I'll do a webinar on functional programming. So this is a Scala function. So this is a Scala function I've written to calculate how much time a function takes to execute. So let's ignore this for the moment. Let's go through the content. So what all we'll cover today? In functional programming, what is functional programming? And what is pure functions? What is not so pure functions? That's something we'll talk about. And what is the side effects? And how to avoid those side effects? And functions as first class citizens. This in functional programming, in the reason why functional programming thrives is functions as first class citizens. We can do a lot more with functions than any other programming paradigm, for example, object oriented programming. And functional programming comes under declarative programming. So we'll touch upon what is declarative programming, what is imperative programming, when to use what. So those distinctions will make it. And then three important concepts in functional programming. Those are partial functions, recursions, and currying. All the three we will touch upon. Okay, so don't worry about the code. Just get the concepts and try applying in your day-to-day coding experience. So let's start with what is a pure function? What is a not so pure function? So I have an example. I'm adding two numbers. This is a function which takes two values, two parameters, x and y. I'm adding two values and then returning the two values. Is that fine? That is a very standard way of adding two numbers. We do this many a times. We write a lot of standard functions and the same function, I have returned it slightly in a different fashion. So what does this do? The first function does, the v1 function, I should have called it OO, but doesn't matter. We calculate the sum and store it in sum and then returning it. That's happening here. Here we don't store anything. We just take the inputs, do the necessary calculations and return it. We don't store it in a variable and then return the variable. These two understandably will give the same results. Let's say add v1, add v2. Let me clear the output here. And let's execute this functions. I'll execute the function one first. Function one, it got defined. Let me define the function two. In function two also it got defined, no error message. Let's see what is the output of the function one. 5. That is expected. Function two also give 5 as expected. But the major difference between the first function and the second function is we create a variable. What happens when we create a variable? What does not happen when we do it like this? So when we create a variable, it creates a memory location in the hard disk or in the RAM. So the disk I/O operation comes into picture. In this case, there is no disk I/O operation. So these two parameters which we give in is going to be remain in the RAM, and the calculation happens in the RAM and it returns from the RAM. So this is more efficient way of programming. This is not so efficient way of programming. We define the variable unnecessarily. So we increase the number of I/O operations. And so what is expected? So let's see, we'll execute these two functions again, but with calculating the time. Okay, so let's calculate the time for the first function. It took 6833 seconds. For the second function, it took lesser seconds, if you notice. It will be quicker. That's what it all means. One, it is quicker. The second function will execute faster compared to the first function because there is one operation lesser. That's how you optimize a program, right? But in functional programming, what we call this as a side effect. We create a variable and we call this as a side effect. Why is it a side effect? All that the function is supposed to do is add these two numbers. But what we are doing, in addition to adding those two numbers, we are also saving it and we are also returning the saved number. So these two actions are unnecessary for the function. So this is what in functional programming is called side effects. Can we write a program without side effects? And that is pure functions. And there are not so pure functions. Out of compulsion, we may have to give in to it, but as far as possible, we'll write functions that are pure. And there are more benefits to write functions pure. Why is that? Let's define the pure functions. What is a pure function? Pure functions are those functions that does not have any side effects. We will talk about more types of side effects shortly, and returns the same output every time executed. For example, square of x, every time I give 5, it's going to return 25. Every time I input 10 into the square of 10, I'm going to get 100. So what does this mean? So once the function executes, it's going to remain in RAM for some time. And every time it does not have to calculate the function for the same output again and again. For example, log values, sine, cos, all those values are all pre-calculated, readily available. And that is the functional approach. We can, once the function calculates for one time, it can retrieve the result n number of times instead of calculating every time. That's why it returns the same output every time. That is a mandatory condition for pure functions. So in this case, let's say I give 5. Second time I give 5, it is not going to do the square. It's going to take it from the stored space. And is every program, is every language going to do this? No. Why is it no? It has to be a functional programming language. Scala is a functional programming language. So every pure function you execute, the values are stored in the memory. It can retrieve the values when a similar same input is given to the function again and again. And when we say functional programming, we say mathematical sense. Y is equal to f of x square. Programming languages have functions, but whenever we say functions in functional programming, we talk in mathematical sense. Is this something everybody is comfortable with? Y is equal to f of x square. Whenever I give x as the input, it's going to do the calculation. It's not going to do anything else. If x is equal to 5, it's going to return 25. It's not going to save anything. Mathematical sense, we are not saving anything anywhere. Whereas programming language functions do it, but here in functional programming, we talk about functions in mathematical sense. That's something all of you should bear in mind. We are going to touch upon this again and again. So I repeat, what is a pure function? Pure functions are those functions that does not have any side effects whatsoever and returns the same output every time you execute it. I think that is clear. What is a pure function? We will talk about what are the functional programming languages. I have listed some. Scala is a programming language that allows you to write both functional programming as well as object-oriented such programming. JavaScript also is in the same manner, whereas these programming languages are purely functional. I haven't explored all the first top five programming languages. I'm comfortable with Scala, but if you want to pick up one of this, these are all purely functional programs. It doesn't allow you to write any other programming, any other style of programming. Okay, and for those who are mostly comfortable with Python, Python is not a functional program. It's not a functional programming language. What do we mean by that? If I execute a function, its results are not stored in the RAM, expecting the same function will be called again with the same input. So every time you call the function gets executed. That's one characteristic. That's not the only characteristic. Python is not a functional programming language, though it approves of functional style of programming. For example, it allows you to write map and reduce in Python, but Python is not a functional programming. Let's bear that in mind. You can write functional way code. Your code can be done in a functional way in Python. Otherwise, Scala is optimized for function programming, and JavaScript also. Okay, that's about functional programming language. We'll talk about side effects. What are the side effects? The side effects are any operation inside the scope of function beyond manipulating the inputs. Let's say I want square of x. Anything other than calculating the square of x is a side effect in that program. For example, we create a variable, store the result in a variable, and return the variable is a side effect. That is one of the side effects. What are the other side effects? Could be one is the declaring the variable as a side effect. We don't need to declare a variable inside the function. That's what it is. And the second one is having any looping or conditional statement. If you are writing more for loops, if you are writing if, while, all those things are not functional. We have to minimize those or get rid of for loops and branching statements. We will see how to get rid of for loops and branching statements, but that is also a side effect. And no function can write to a file, which means we are working on an ecosystem outside that function. So that's a side effect. Updating a database, that is also not part of the function. Database is outside the scope of a function, so that is also a thing. Functions cannot have exceptions. That is also a side effect here. And the print statement inside the functions are also side effect. So your functions should not have any of the side effects. Just be mindful when you write functions. At the debugging stage, you may have a print statement, but as far as possible, you should not have print statements inside a function. You can have print statements outside the function. That's what these are the side effects of the function. Basically, this is not limited to this. Anything that is not manipulating the variables is a side effect. Anything you do beyond what is bare minimum required is a side effect. Let's call it like that. Okay, so let's see how do we avoid a if statement. I have avoided a if statement. What is the requirement here? Requirement here is to if the value of x is greater than 3, I want square of x. Otherwise, I want cube of x. So this is how we write the function in a standard manner. We take the input and we give the if statement. What happens when you give the if statement? The compiler branches out. If something is true, there's a branch there. If something is false, there's a branch there. So from that point, there are two sets of execution statements for the compiler or interpreter. So we'll have to avoid that. So how would we avoid that? So I have written it like this. So what do I do is if x is greater than 3, that will be a true. And if this both are true, this will return 1. If x is greater than 3, it will return 1, otherwise 0. When it is 0, this whole thing will be 0. Square will not get calculated. Whereas in the other side, it will get calculated. I hope this is clear. I'm avoiding the if statement totally. This will be calculated if x is greater than 3. This will be calculated if x is less than 3. if in case x is less than 3, this will return me 0. If x is greater than 3, this will return me 0. I am adding two operations. So without an if statement, purely using the bool operation, bool and whether the bool operation returns a true or not, based on that, I have worked out a way to avoid if statement, branching conditions. That's what it is. So it is going to give the same results. Let's see, let's execute this. Let me execute the function, define the functions first. Okay, no errors. This is O stands for object oriented programming, FN stands for functional programming. So it's going to give me same output. Since 5 is greater than 3, it's going to square. If 5 is less than 3, it's going to, if we give 3 or 2 as the input, it's going to do the cube. It's going to do the cube in both the cases. You see that it's returning the cube as the result. So this one drawback is this does not always result in quicker execution of the function. This takes a little longer, but when it compiles, if you look at it at a larger scale, this will be efficient. So I have the time taken for both the functions. You can see this is taking 33,000 nanoseconds. If I write the same in functional way, it's going to take more than that, 67,000 nanoseconds. So this is something happens when you look at it at the statement level, but if you look at it at a look at the larger picture, this will make sense. So this is one way you can optimize your program. You don't have to give a if statements, so that compiler does not track two set of statements. It will track only one set of statements. Okay, so next is the looping functionality. Now we spoke about two things. One is looping, another is branching. We would want to understand how we can avoid looping and branching. I have values from 1 to 10. I take values from 1 to 10 and I assign it to A. This itself is a side effect. Okay, in for loop, what happens? We assign the value to a variable and that variable is what we are manipulating it. We notice here A is what we are manipulating it. And this is how we write a if statement in Scala. I am sure many of you must be comfortable with if statements. That should not be a problem. I give this 1 to 10 as the input and get the squares as the output. As you see, you can see the squares here. Or I want to want me to execute one more time. I'll execute it. One second. I clear it. I execute this one more time. So it's giving me the square of the list which I passed in, square of the set of the numbers I have passed in. So how is this for loop executed? How would you draw the logic diagram, or how is this for loop executed? It takes the one, assign it to A, and it gets the square of A. It takes the next value 2, assign it to A, gets the square of A, it gets 3, assign it to E, and gets the square of A. Up until 10, it's going to do this. So what is happening here? How can we optimize this? If you notice this logic, it executes things in a sequential manner. So it first does 1, gets the 1 square, 2, 2 square, 3, 3 square, until 10. So it's iterating the loop 10 times, one after the another. So when we execute one, after that, if we execute 3, would it matter? Should we execute it sequentially always? Let's say I have 10 computers. I can use all 10 computers at the same time and give 1, 2, 3 for 10 computers, 10 numbers, and get the result quicker, right? So this has scope for a lot of optimization. Yes, any questions? We'll take a break here. So far, any questions before we jump in? People?
No, sir. It's fine.
Good. Okay, then I'll continue. Stop me when you want to. All of you, all your mics are enabled, so stop me when you want to. So this is the looping functionality. Loop automatically, what it does is it takes one value after the another value. So it's 10 executions sequentially happens. It doesn't do anything in parallel until we explicitly state so. Python also, many programming languages has multi-processing, multi-threading. You can do it in parallel. All 10 values can go in parallel and come back, but those have to be explicitly stated. But for loop does it one after the another. How do we avoid this for loop is something we'll see this sooner, very soon. Now, functional programming, the main advantage of the functional programming is functions are treated as first class citizens. What do we mean by functions as treated as first class citizens? Let's go back to our object-oriented programming or a procedural programming for that matter. Variables are the first class citizens always, or data are the first class citizens mostly. What do we do with the data? Let's say I define a variable called x. What all can I do with that x? I can assign that x to another variable. I can pass that x to any function I want to and get it manipulated. And I can do a lot more things with that x variable, right? Now, can I do the same with functions? If I am capable of doing using the functions same way as variables, then we are doing functional programming. Then functions are treated as same as variables or as first class citizens. So what is this first thing? Function can be assigned to variables. We'll look at the example. This is called partial functions. That's how it is implemented. We'll see the implementation. And the functions can be passed to functions as arguments. You can write a function that takes another function as an argument. And the implementation is higher order functions. And the third thing is any function can return a variable in object-oriented programming. In functional programming, a function call can return another function. This is called currying in functional programming parlance. Okay, we'll see examples for all three. This is, pay some attention to this. Okay, so we have a function called y is equal to fx, f of 2x plus 3. Okay, if we give x, it's going to give me a new y. X is equal to 0 will give me a new y. X is equal to 1 will give me a new result. X is equal to 3 will give me a new result. X is equal to 100 will give me a new result. So this is the function I'm trying to achieve. So I have the list of values for which this function should be executed and give me the result as the list of values. That is the requirement. So how would we typically do it? We take the list of values as the input, and for each value in the list of values, we calculate this and store it in a list and return. Is this clear? Now, how will I avoid it? So I will draw your attention to this image here. So this is the function. These are the inputs. These are the outputs. Everybody's clear with this? This is what we do it in functional programming. So we have 10 inputs. If we get back to our thing, we have 10 inputs in a list. We need 10 outputs in a list, and one input can have maximum of one output. One input cannot have maximum of more than one output. This is the quality of the function. This is called in mathematical parlance. What is this called? One-to-one functions. You notice one input cannot have two outputs in any of this. It's called one-to-one function. So if you look at it like that, so we have to give an input, and each input is going to have an output, and one input is not going to affect the other input. So that's the idea, right? So we have something called map in functional programming. It's going to take the each input from the list and calculate this. So it's not going to do it sequentially. In this case, it's going to happen sequentially, one by one by one. In this case, it will optimize depending on what your infrastructure is and how free is your infrastructure. If my laptop has 8 cores, each core can do 2 operations at a time, which means I can do 16 operations at a time. or more than that also. If no, that's about the that's we leave it to the programming framework that is Scala and infrastructure to play with it. But I am not instructing do it sequentially. I am saying I want this output for each value in the numlist. I want an output of this calculation. I am not giving any other instruction. Do it parallelly, do it sequentially. I am not giving any other instruction. So the map function is going to help me do it in an optimized manner. So you see the difference between these two. So this should take longer time. That is return function results in an object oriented way. Return function results in a functional programming way. It's going to return the same output. Let's see if it's returning the same output. I will clean the screen. Let's see for this first. It's calculating. It's returning 579. Yes, 2x plus 3, right? For every x, it's going to do 2x plus 3. Let's do the same thing in a map using map. So in this, the beauty is here we are not using for loop. Let's just be mindful of that. It's giving me the same result. Let's see how much time did each of it take. Time taken for the object oriented way is, let me clean this up further. Time taken to do it in the object oriented way is 14,000 nanoseconds. Let's see if it is doing the same in here. It's doing slightly higher, 15,000 nanoseconds. Let's say I give the same input. This time it is taking 85,000 nanoseconds. This is happening because it's giving me the total list. This is 11,000. This is taking slightly longer, but I have to work it out. This calculating the total time taken for all 10 inputs, even if it is done in parallel fashion, but this will be quicker, trust me. Okay, so this is called functionally doing the loops. You always use map to do the loops functionally. Let's see. Now it's time to understand what is an imperative programming and declarative programming. How is this two functions different? In this case, we explicitly say take the numbers in the list one by one. In this case, we don't explicitly say. We say these are the numbers, you optimize it and execute the functions for me. That's the main difference between these two. So when we say, when we control the flow of computations, that is imperative. When we leave the flow of computation to the system and the programming language framework, that is declarative. That's all the difference. So imperative program, we control the flow of computation. We explicitly state the flow of computation should happen in this fashion. And that's what is called procedural programming language. And these are data or object centric programming. Imperative programming is data or object centric programming. We explicitly state the flow of computation, how it should be done, and it's going to do it procedurally. Whereas in declarative programming, it optimizes the flow of computation. We don't have to do anything and we don't state any flow. Or we give the logic and then we'll say what we want and we will leave the computer to do the job. And that is mostly function centric programming. So this is the different imperative and declarative. This is the core difference between the imperative and declarative programming languages. So functional programming falls under declarative programming language. So that's something you can be mindful of. Yeah. So what we learned is we avoided the for loop. We did not write a for loop when we wanted to process multiple values, which can be processed in parallel, by the way, which is imperative, which is declarative. That's something we got it clear. Let's move. Now that we know numlist.map will give me the values, we can go on extending this. The instruction is take the numlist, map each value, calculate the function, whatever I'm giving in, and do the sum. Let's see, it does 140. So you have all three things done in a pipe. First operation will result in the input to the next operation. Second operation will result in the input to the third operation, and third operation will give you the result. So this is a very elegant way of writing the code, and all you want is in one line, and your code doesn't run into pages, and you avoid all the side effects. If you notice, we are not creating any variable here. The num list is what is being used, but we can always say list dot range of 1 to 10. This will also result in same thing. There is no variable at all. Okay, I have a, I think 1, 10. Yes, it should be 1, 11 because it 1 to 10 is accounted when we say 1 to 11, 140. So no variable is defined, no side effects whatsoever, and it's all available in one single line. This is the piping, and why should I do sum? If I want to get the maximum value of the previous result, I got a result of 10 values in a list, I want a maximum, or I want to do the multiplication of all of this. So a lot more operations are there. Those operations, whatever you do in list to get a result is called reduce operation. In fact, you can get on extending map x. This will give me the x square. And then it will do the sum. You can add any number of maps. If you notice here, it's going to do the job. Okay, I have got a equal to here. So the result will get squared. So one for each value, it will get squared, and then it will do the sum. Let's see. Now I got 2290. So you can go on chaining it or pipelining it, and it will be elegant. Your code will be in all in one place. You don't have to and you get rid of all the side effects. So a lot of benefits with this. So I go down. How to do max? So the sum operation is like this when you use reduce. Whenever you want to reduce, you're going to take the values in the list two at a time, that is x, y, and what operation you want to return. You want to keep adding every value, then this also is going to return me. Okay, sorry, what happened? Okay. See, it returned me 140. This is how when you do reduce. In this case, it's going to return the max. It's going to take the num list. It's going to execute the function for each values in the num list, and it's going to reduce. What is it going to reduce? It's going to take two values at a time, or initialize with one value and take one value at a time, and it compares both and returns the max. So this chains itself, and you are going to get the maximum value of the maximum value in this case is 23. So reduce is an operation which is done on a list. That's important. You have a list, and reduce is an operation which is done on that list, and it's going to result in one number, not a list. You want another list, you have to do a map. You can chain the map, or you can reduce the result to one number. So this is another function, map and reduce. This map and reduce capabilities are available in Python also. So if some people are comfortable in Python, they can explore. This is how you do the functional programming. We don't write for loop. We don't assign values to variables. We do all the calculations and return the result alone. And that result is either printed on the screen or goes to the database. But when it comes to functions, it's pure function. Okay, now let's do one more thing. Now we did all this. We avoided the for loop. That's what we learned. And we did learn about pipelining and map and reduce as the functions. Let's go to the next level. So we have a function called square. All of you clear what is this function do? This takes an input and it squares the input. That's all. That doesn't even take a list. It takes one value and it squares. Let's execute this function. Okay, we executed it. And I create a list, and it's so nice to call it like this, right? I create a list, and for in the list, this, since this is a only one parameter function, mind that. Any function that has only one parameter, you can do it like this. You will have a list and map with the square. It's going to pass each value in the list to this function, and it's going to give me the result in a list. And this is possible when there is only one parameter in the function. there are workarounds. If there are more than one parameters, we can work around and call it one parameter. For example, I'll call it a tuple, or I'll call it a list. List will be a one parameter, or a tuple will be a one parameter. Workarounds are there, but we'll get into that later when we go to the advanced level. But if you have only one parameter, I can use this map square function. Much more nicer way of coding. If you notice, there is no, for example, here there's a lot of clutter. Here there is no clutter. I'm calling it square. Go, this can do any complicated operation. This can do the same operation. This can go and do the same operation. Big deal. So any complicated operation can be written inside a function. And if that function is only one parameters, has only one parameters, and this nicely summarizes the whole thing. Very elegant way of calling a function for a list of values. Okay, so this is another thing. This is what we call it, higher order functions. We are passing square, that is a function, as a parameter to the map function. This is called higher order functions. Anytime you pass a function to another function in functional programming parlance, in functional programming, you can do this. Not in an object-oriented programming. You have a function, you cannot pass a function inside the another function. So this is called higher order functions. Now you can, why should it be map? I can write another function here and then call that function. And for that function, I can pass on square as a function. This is nice and elegant way of doing things. And let's address shortly, what if I have more than one variables? What if I have X, Y, Z, all the three variables in, how will I call it like this? Or how will I reduce the function with more than one parameter into a one parameter? Let's look at it. Then, okay, now we understood function can be given as a parameter to another function. Now how to use a function as a variable? What do we mean by function as a variable? Now I have a function called square. Can I assign this to a variable? In any other programming language, is that possible? And what am I going to achieve by assigning to a variable? That's something we'll look at it next, function as a variable. So I create a raise to as a function, and then it takes a, what should I raise to? Should I raise it to power 2 or should I raise it to power 10? And what is the num list? And I'm going to return something as a double list. So for each of this, I'm going to do this. So let's execute it. And I have a execution like this. If I want square of the list, I give raise to 2. If I want cube of the list, I say raise to 3, comma num list. If I want to raise to 10, I'll give it. So it's my choice. So first place, this raise to function is not written in a functional manner. I've used for loop here. And then let's see what it returns. See here, for 1, 2, 3, it returns all the cube values. For 10, 10 cube is 1000. Agreed? Now I want to assign it to a variable. What I can do is raise to these two values. I'm not giving now because I'm assigning, I'm leaving it as underscore. I'm assigning to a value called a. And I can use this value of a as a function anywhere I want it. Now a will be raise to function. And instead of saying raise to 3, comma num list, I can say a of 2, comma num list. So big deal. Well, why don't I keep it as raise to itself? Why will I assign it to a and call a instead of raise to? No, nothing much is happening here, right? Let's see how further this is going to be useful. Now, when I say raise to, there are two placeholders, if you notice. Now I'll do one more thing. This is called partial functions. I'll say raise to 2. And the other parameter is variable. In this case, I create a variable called pow underscore 2. Now I can pass only the num list. See, I have reduced the raise to function, which has two parameters, to a function which gets to only one parameter. Power of 2, and I can give the num list. I can give the power of 3, where raise to 3, comma the other input. And I can say power of 3 and num list. Is this clear? We have successfully reduced two variables or n variables into a one variable function, but we have to handle this input which we are giving and the function name in an intelligent manner. You can think of various implementations, probably loop, probably another function. All that can be thought through. So this is how you reduce it. This is called partial functions. You have 10 parameters. You apply one parameter now, leave the 9 parameters to be applied later. This is called partial functions in functional programming. This can be leveraged a lot in our day-to-day work. I do it. So this is the power of three. Any questions on partial functions or anything so far? All the code is all in Scala, but you can replicate in any language. Another application is recursion. All of you understand what is a factorial value, and this is how factorial function is written in an object-oriented programming language. We initialize it with one, and for each value from 1 to n, we multiply with the previous value and store it in the value, and then returns the value f. So this is how an object-oriented fashion it is written. And if you want to do recursion, then it's a lot simple. If you notice here, we do branch that can be avoided. We do branch here, but it is using the recursion. So we are not declaring any variable. We take the value that has been inputted for our use. And then we check if the value is one. Otherwise, we call the recursion and the whole thing is going to return. The result is going to get returned to this function. So both same. Factorial 5 will get same amount of 120. Functional value also is going to be 120. But if you look at the time taken for the object-oriented program, it's 21,000 seconds. For functional program, it's 6,000 seconds or 7,000 seconds for that matter. Somewhere between 6 and 7, if you see here, it is 21,000 seconds. So what is again important is we don't have side effects in this example. Functional example, we don't have side effects. We only call functions or we manipulate the input. That's all. So this is going to be very pronounced if I say 50 and 50, let's see. I think, okay, it took 23,000 seconds again. In this case, it took 17,000 seconds. So it's going to be effective as the numbers grow. So we are almost done. We'll touch upon currying and then we will open up for the Q&As. So what is currying? Currying is similar to converting partial functions where we have two parameters. We reduced it to one parameter function. If you notice here, that's what is happening. But if we don't want to do it like this, currying is another way. Currying has much larger purpose. Basically, what currying is going to do is it's going to return a function. Let's read this. I'm going to say initialize. It's taking two parameters, A and B, and this in between the equal to is important because we'll come to that. It's going to take two parameters and it's going to add the two parameters and return me a value. Then now what is this equal to in between saying is I'm not going to give all the two parameters together. I'll give one parameter at some time, second parameter little later. That's what this equal to means. If I have a third parameter, I will say, I can say C int. I want to give two more parameters later. Okay, that's the idea. So let's restrict to two parameters. So I initialize this function. Let us do it one by one. So I initialize this function and it has returned a function. It takes the int as an input, int as an output, all that is fine. Now what I do is I give only one parameter to the function and I assign that. Let's see what is there in the add. See, it returned a function, lambda function. So initialize 10, basically I've initialized the value a with 10 and left the value b open. Now add is a function. This initialize function, I called it, it returned a function. What is the function it returned? It returned a function which is called add, which will take one parameter and do this operation. So add is a function. Now I go here and say add 15, I get 25. When I say add 25, what will get? Anybody? When I say add 25, what I'll get?
35.
Okay, it's going already initialized with 10. When I say add 25, it's going to get 35. I can say add 250 also. It's going to get 260. So basically the thing is, the original purpose of currying is it's going to return a function. That's what. It's the purpose is not to reduce the function to one parameter function. It can return two parameter functions. It can return three parameter function. All that is possible. So in this case, we have reduced it to one function, one parameter function, that is add function. All that you have to give. What is the first set of inputs you will give? What is the second set of inputs you will give? What is the third set of inputs you will give? You can decide. Third set of inputs, I want to give another variable. Let's say C, which is another int, which means val subtract. Okay. Add 5. So what will subtract have? Okay, let's see what is it doing. Okay, only one is possible. I will do comma. Okay, or let's say two values, and then let's say a plus b minus c. Okay, so this is the function. I do this, and then I execute, initialize with 10, agreed, and then add 5. Will it work? No, it will expect two parameters, because we said we'll give two parameters after the first parameter is done. So let's still execute. What happens? It will say it's executing two values. So let's say add 5 comma 2. What will be the result now?
It'll add 5 and subtract 2.
Subtract 30. That's all. So you can do the other way around also. You can initialize it with two parameters and probably D. And you can have more than that also. So it's up to you to play with it. What it's doing is, when you call that initialize function with first set of parameters, it's going to create a function with the second set of parameters. And it's going to return a function for us. So the purpose of currying is to return functions from function. Return function from function. So this is the capability. How you play with this up to every developer. But this is nice capability. I have applied this in real time use cases. It has come handy. Flexibility. So this is the currying function, currying capabilities. And we spoke about functional programming. Functions are first class citizens. That doesn't mean we can ignore object oriented programming. So functional programming and object oriented programming is what we do it together. But functions, as far as possible, I keep it pure. If you go to pure functional programming like Haskell and other programming languages, there you cannot define an object also. I don't know. I haven't explored a pure functional programming. I use Scala a lot. So I use both object oriented programming and functional programming to achieve an end. I enjoyed it. I hope you also enjoy it. But whatever we covered so far are just the tip of the iceberg. Okay. So you want to do a lot more? Go to YouTube and look for Scott Lashchin. He explains functional programming like nobody else does, and a lot deeper concepts. He has a lot of 1 hour videos in the YouTube. But only thing is, his programming language will be F#. And he has programming language agnostic explanations of functions. So go, and that's going to give you, take your functional programming knowledge to another level. Scott Lashchin, that's the person I follow. And if you want to go further advanced, you want to understand where this, how this functional programming evolved, how from where did they take the basics from? It's all coming from group theory. Group theory is where functional programming's roots are, and most of this are group theory concepts. Monads, applicatives, and functors. Functors are nothing but map. Monads are flat maps, and applicatives are also, I don't remember exactly. So if you want to go deeper in the functional programming domain, you can learn group theory and especially these three concepts. There are a lot of articles, Medium articles, towards data science articles, which gives a very introduction to dummies kind of things for this thing. And another thing you should look for is the language specific nuances. Scala, it implements the functional programming, but it has its own nuances. JavaScript will have its own nuances. Please watch out for those nuances and you will be good. These are the advanced stuff when you want to take your skills to the next level. So this is the code base. Only code I didn't explain is this time function. Basically, this takes the code block, executes the code block, and gives how much time did it take to execute the code block. That's for our evaluation sake, I have put it, not to worry about it. Now we'll open up the stage for questions and then we can call it a day. Any questions? People? All good?
I had one question. Here, sure. For example, if you are using Python or C++, where will this be useful typically?
See, Python is not a functional programming language, but they give these capabilities. You can use the map and reduce functions and partial functions. All this are available as libraries. All these are available as libraries. You should be able to use this from what we have covered today.
Thanks.
That's about in Python. I'm not sure about C++. Not sure if C++ is a functional programming language also. I know it's object-oriented programming language. So any other questions from anybody else?
Just to add to that answer, this is Arvind here. So in Python, we also have comprehensions which are much more elegant than using map or filter or reduce. So
yeah.
The way to write Pythonic code is to use those comprehensions as much as possible. In some rare cases, you can use the partial functions. So that facility is there as part of core Python.
Yeah.
But I have not used it much in my programming experience. Mostly I use Go with Python comprehensions, be it list, set, or dictionary, or generators. I go with the comprehension approach.
So all of you will code using functional programming going forward. Somebody is asking a question in the chat window.
Yeah, you can answer that.
This is just one use case, but any idea why JustPay has reportedly used Haskell? Haskell is a pure functional programming language. They don't allow anything else. I'm not sure why JustPay has adopted you Haskell. Okay, you are asking why they have not used object-oriented programming. I have no visibility into it. My take would be there are best of both the worlds. We want to get it, we can use Scala, but I'm not sure about the JustPay.
Yeah, so I will try to answer this to the best of my knowledge. See, the whole purpose of side effects, which Ramanathan has touched upon, side effects are a bad thing. say, take for example, in typical languages, you might have a global variable. So even though you may be calling a function, that function is changing some global variable. So that is a side effect, because a function is not supposed to do that in a functional programming language. So what is the problem with global variables? You don't know how the variable gets updated. So when your program becomes very large and complex, the global variables could have been updated from any number of functions. And it becomes a nightmare to debug who has updated the global variable. And the problem is worse when you have multiple threads running in your program. So you have multiple threads running, you don't know which thread has caused, and there is a potential of race conditions as well. So these are all the different reasons why people wanted to go towards functional programming languages, because the fundamental thing is there are no side effects. Everything is controlled through the calling of functions, so it becomes easier to debug and control your program. So this is probably why some companies like JustPay, for example, they adopt a purely functional programming language such as Haskell. So Ramanathan has pointed you to some of the useful references on YouTube and Medium and stuff like that. So from my perspective, I can share you. I will share my screen shortly.
Sure, you can go ahead.
So from my perspective, I will. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, so on Devopedia, we have an article already on functional programming. It was written long back. So those of you who are new to functional programming, you can read through this. It will give you a good quick overview. So what exactly do you mean by side effects? What conditions should a programming language, satisfy to be considered functional? How is it different from imperative programming? Can you explain pure functions, first class functions, higher order functions? So many of this has been covered by Ramanathan. What are some of the concepts and features of functional programming? So Ramanathan covered some of these things: first class functions, higher order functions, pure functions, recursion, manipulation of lists. So he has covered the most of it. Then we have, what are the techniques? So he has covered some of the techniques: pipelining, partial functions. Other things you can read about it in this article: continuation, lazy evaluation, pattern matching, tail call optimization. Why and when should we use functional programming? So I tried to explain some of this in Pawan's question. For that, I answered with some of this. So this will give you more insights why and when we should use functional programming, and who is using functional programming in the real world. So some examples are given here. So in fact, Haskell is quite popular in the industry. Many use cases of Haskell in the industry is well documented. Which programming languages are considered functional? So there are quite a few of them. Some are even considered as hybrid languages like Scala and F#. So in fact, Ramanathan mentioned that, in the sense that in Scala, you can not only do functional programming approach, you can also do object-oriented programming. So much so that some people consider F# and Scala to be both. So they give a new name, object functional programming, because they are a combination of both FP and OOP. And other interesting questions: why did functional programming take so long to get popular? How is functional programming different from lambda calculus, and some historical background? How did we arrive at functional programming? There are also two other articles, one on declarative programming and one on imperative programming. Unfortunately, these have not been authored. So I think somebody started this, Bala Manohar, he started this long back, but he didn't get to completing this article. So any of you interested in writing these articles, you are more than welcome. Because Devopedia is an open platform, all you need is an account. Then you can write these two articles, imperative programming and declarative programming. And once the articles reach a certain level of quality, we will publish them. But meanwhile, you can read all about functional programming in this article.